Thank you.
Okay. Oh.
Hi, everybody. My name is Phil Nugent with Parks Canada. Before we get started today, we have a quick message from Mayor Nenshi.
Hi, it's Mayor Nahid Nenshi here. And you know, normally, the first week of June is one of my favorite times of year to be at City Hall because the Mayor's Environment Expo takes over the whole place. Hundreds of students and teachers and parents and exhibitors all talking about how we can keep our land, our air, and our water clean and safe for everyone. Of course, it's a little different this year again because we can't be together. But nonetheless, so many folks have worked so hard to make sure that you have the opportunity to still have a great Mayor's Environment Expo and to learn about all the ways that you can help the environment. So a special thank you to all of my colleagues at the City of Calgary who come together to put this on. A thank you to our venue partners at the Calgary Public Library and the University of Calgary School of Architecture, Planning and Landscape for putting this all together. Et je comprends aussi qu'il y a des sessions en français cette année, et c'est merveilleux, bravo pour étudier en français et pour apprendre toutes les choses qu'on peut faire pour améliorer l'environnement. And my best thanks, of course, go to the teachers who worked hard to make this work within their crazy world of changing how they teach, and especially a thank you to all of the students involved. I know this has been a really rough year. I know that we've had to learn completely new ways of doing things and new ways of learning. But I also know that young people have shown that they are truly resilient, that students are focusing on what really matters and how we move forward. And especially in this time of climate change, one of the things that really matters is all of our responsibility to the environment. So have a great virtual Mayor's Environment Expo, everyone.
Hi, we're back once again. And once again, my name is Philip Nugent, and I am part of the Parks Canada team here in Banff National Park. Thank you very much for joining us today to find out about how and why we study wolves here in Banff. For the next 40 minutes or so, I will be hosting from the studio here, and Lori, my friend, will be hosting from the field, where she is going to take us on a virtual tour of this wonderful place. We're also going to make sure that at the end of our presentation, we have some time for questions. So if you think of a question while we're presenting, just make sure you throw it in the chat and we will do our best to get to it and answer it at the end. So today we know this place as the famous Banff National Park. It is Canada's first national park, but the roots of this place are far deeper. We acknowledge that Banff National Park is within the present day territory of Treaty 6, 7 and 8, as well as the Métis homeland. The lands and waters of Banff have been used for millennia by Indigenous peoples for sustenance, ceremony, trade, and travel. We thank them for their continuous stewardship and for sharing the land with us. It is my privilege today to help you understand the natural and cultural heritage of these special places. Banff is one of Canada's 48 national parks from coast to coast to coast. Can anyone let me know in the chat if they've ever visited a national park before? Parks Canada looks after all of these special places, plus over 170 national historic sites, 4 national marine conservation areas, historic canals, and Pingo National Landmark. Some of our Parks Canada team studies how we can keep the ecosystems of our national parks healthy and whole. And that's what we call ecological integrity. We're going to go to Lori now on location in Banff National Park to help explain what that means. Lori?
Thank you. Hello, bonjour, everybody. My name is Lori, and I am part of the Parks Canada team here in Banff National Park. So what is ecological integrity anyway? Well, here it means that we have an ecosystem that is healthy and whole. So we have all the parts and the processes that are normal for this place in a way that they will persist for generations to come. Still confused? Let me break this down one more step. So all around me are the Rocky Mountains, And there's lots of non-living parts to this place, such as the rocks and the wind and the water and the sunshine and glaciers. And then, of course, we have all the living parts that are all around me as well. Plants, animals, fungi, bacteria, even if we can't see them. And all of those living parts of this place are subject to processes of life. Birth, growth, reproduction, death, and decay. Now, let's not forget as well, there are all kinds of non-biological processes that happen here too. We've got avalanches, floods, fires, and seasons. And in this place, we want all of these things to work together and persist for generations to come. That's what we call ecological integrity. So, Banff National Park, to have a healthy and whole ecosystem here, that includes having top predators like wolves. Now, in the early days of the park, our park managers thought that wolves didn't belong here, and it was actually legal to hunt and kill them. But since those days, we have learned exactly how important to our ecosystem the wolves are.
Thanks, Laurie. We'll be back with you in just a moment. So, why do we study wolves? Wolves are hunters with a large home range. They're what is known as a keystone species, because just like a keystone holds an arch together, wolves hold together a whole ecosystem. If we know what to change in our park to help the wolves survive, we can be fairly sure that those changes will benefit other species as well. How we study wolves involves some very cool technology. Wolves are really good at keeping out of sight of humans, so we have to get creative in order to observe them. Today, Lori is going to show us some of the tools we use to learn about wolves, and then I will tell you how we apply that knowledge to managing our busy park so that the wolves can thrive here. Lori?
Are you ready? We are going to start with this bit of technology right here. This is a radio telemetry receiver, and it looks kind of like a walkie-talkie, right? But what this device actually does is it tunes into the individual radio frequencies of our research collars. Now in Banff National Park, we certainly don't collar or even ear tag every single animal. But when they are wearing a radio collar, this is how we track them down. So I'm just going to turn on this device here. You're going to hear it in action. Are you hearing that little click, click, click? That's the sound that the radio collar is making. And I happen to know that there is a collar quite nearby here that hasn't moved in a couple of weeks. So I think that it's probably been dropped off of the animal that was wearing it, and it would be safe to approach. Because of course we would never want to approach a live wolf, right? All right, let's go and see if we can find this collar and retrieve it. So the way that this works is kind of like playing warmer, colder, because when we're facing the direction that the collar is, it gets louder. And when we turn away, that signal gets quieter. So I'm thinking it's over this way someplace. Aha, I can see it. There we go. I can turn that off because I have found the collar. This is a radio research collar, and it has done exactly the thing that it was supposed to do. This was worn by a wolf for about a year and a half, and you can see this little part right here, this fabric bit, has actually frayed and broken apart. And that is what it's exactly what it's supposed to do. So that wears over time and falls off because we want this to naturally detach from the animal after a year or two, because that's about how long the battery life is inside the radio collar. So I'm going to collect this and bring it back to the lab.
Thanks, Laurie. Radio collars like that one require staff to go out and to track them in the field and make notes. We also have GPS collars, which are more expensive, but give us a lot more information for less effort. Does anybody here watching have a cell phone? And has anyone here had to use the Find My Phone feature? I know I have had to because I lose my phone a lot. Well, your phone has a chip inside of it that can relay information about its location. The chip in a GPS collar does the same thing and automatically sends an update of the caller's location every few minutes. That information goes directly to our computers, and then we can keep a detailed record of where the wolf is spending its time in the park. Parks Canada is careful to determine when and why an animal is collared. We might want to find out how a species is using the landscape. How far do they travel, where, and when? Or maybe there's an animal that's been getting too comfortable around a campground. It might need to be tracked and relocated, or even destroyed. Because the process of attaching collars and other types of remote tracking devices can be stressful on wildlife, Parks Canada adopts very rigorous standards to minimize impact on the animal. With wolves, believe it or not, we don't use any sedation to apply a collar. The process is really quick. First, the wolf is caught in a net deployed from a helicopter. Next, our team pins the wolf with a special device, and then we carefully apply a muzzle and leg restraints to hold the wolf down. On goes the collar, and then we take any blood or tissue samples that we might need. Once we remove the collar, the muzzle, and the leg restraints, we let go. And this operation takes about 10 to 15 minutes in total, which minimizes the stress on the wolves. Now I'm going to play an animation of 1 year's worth of wolf GPS collar information that we collected. Let's see if you can figure out which parts of the valley the wolves use the most. And I'll give you a hint. The white parts are the high mountain peaks and the green parts are the low valley bottoms. Also, watch for names of wolf prey that pops up and see if you can count which type of prey the wolves caught the most. Are you ready? Here we go. As you're watching this, if you also look up at the top corner there, you can see the dates that these locations were taken from, as well as the distance that that wolf has traveled in total. All right, so where did the wolves spend most of their time? Ray, let us know in the chat if you think that it was high up in the mountains or low in the valleys. And for those of you who chose low in the valley bottoms, you are correct. That is where the wolves prefer to be. From studies like this, we know that wolves use the Bow Valley a lot, and so do people. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that later. Was anybody able to figure out what the wolf pack ate the most? Let us know in the chat if you think you know what it is. That's right. For those of you who guessed mule deer, you are correct. They also ate a lot of white-tailed deer, moose, mountain goats, and elk. So we can tell that they have a pretty varied diet of large herbivores. And if you were paying attention, you may have also noticed that they ate some hare and some beaver and even a coyote in that 1 year time lapse. So how do you think we figured out what those wolves ate? Well, we had to get out there in the field and follow the clues. When a radio or a GPS collar information shows a wolf hanging around the same place for a few days, that might be a clue that they have a deer or elk carcass there to eat. And I think Lori's actually found something for us. So we're gonna cut to Lori now. Lori, are you there?
Look at what we have here, friends. Fresh wolf tracks. Very exciting to find. We're very lucky to find them in the mud like this in the spring. Look at the size of that imprint. So when a biologist finds hints like this, wolf tracks, sometimes we can actually follow the trail of the wolf. But Here's the trick. We don't want to follow the trail in the direction that the wolf was heading because we don't want to come up behind it, change its behavior, or actually come close to that animal. So we do the opposite. We go in the opposite direction and go in the direction that the wolf came from. We call this backtracking. So it's much easier to do in the winter when we have fresh snow because I just have a very few tracks sequencing in the mud here, and then I lose it on the other side of that water in the grass. So we can record this backtracking information on a specially designed map with what we call transects. Okay, so transects are basically a grid that we draw over the map of Banff National Park so that we can check for tracks in the same places again and again and again, year after year. And when we put the tracking information with the transects together with the collar location information, that gives us a really clear picture of where the wolves are going and what they need us to change in this environment in our Banff National Park in order to help them survive.
Thanks, Laurie. So here we have a real life example of how transect and tracking studies helped us to help the wolves. The Banff Bow Valley study showed that wolves had a tough time getting around the outskirts of the town of Banff. The yellow lines that you can see on this map over here, those represent the movements of wolves through the valley. These red lines that you see represent the movements of cougars. So here we have this orange blob here. That is the town site of Banff. This is our before picture. So up here we have a summer camp. Down close to the town, there was a bison paddock. And then right at the base of Cascade Mountain was an airstrip. And all of this was blocking the traffic of wolves and animal movement through the valley. So when we remove those fences and buildings and reduce the human activity there, let's see what happens. Pretty amazing, right? It reduced the stress on the wolves and they were able to move more freely through this wildlife corridor. It's a big difference, right? Let's go back to Lori now and see if she's found anything else for us. Lori, are you there?
Well, my friends, I have found a very clear clue that wolves have been here. And it's right down here on the ground. A naturalist would call this scat, but you might know it as good old-fashioned poop. Yes, and it is important to biologists because this poo can give us clues about a wolf's life and the stuff that it's eating. So I'm going to actually take a sample. I came prepared. I always have a little collection baggie with me. And I'm going to put on my PPE. Let's do the mask first. I've got a mask and gloves. And I put these on before handling any materials like this because wolf scat can actually contain tapeworm eggs, and I don't want to inhale or swallow any of those. So I'm going to mask up before I handle it. Also going to put on some gloves because I do not want to handle poop with my bare hands. Go figure. All right. So once I am set up here, I'm going to pick this up and we're going to see what kind of clues we can find inside these droppings. Now they're quite old. You can see they're sun bleached. And they've dried right out. They've been here a while. So we have a lot of hair in here. You can see that hair doesn't get digested. And to me, this looks an awful lot like deer hair. And a really cool thing I've got here is a little bit of bone. So that bone might get swallowed, but it doesn't get digested. So that comes right out the other end of the wolf and shows up in the scat. So we can take this sample back to the lab and it can tell us the DNA of the wolf and the DNA of the prey that it was eating. I'm gonna just get my baggie here and we will bag that up to take back to the lab. Now I want to pick up one more thing over here, and I think that this is related, my friends. That's a pretty old scat. And here we have a pretty old skull. And this is a deer skull. So this could be the very same deer that went through the digestive system of that wolf. Now this is all that's left after the wolves have had their fill and all of the scavengers have come to finish cleaning off all the bones. And when a wolf pack makes a kill, they not only feed themselves, but they feed many other kinds of animals as well. So all those scavengers like crows, ravens, magpies, wolverines will just eat the straight up bone. And then of course all the insects that come in to clean off the last little bits of flesh off of a carcass, right? So the wolves are having this huge impact on their whole ecosystem. Now, when we find predation sites like this, it confirms that we can figure out what exactly the wolves were eating. So we put this predation site information together with our collar tracking information and our transect studies, and that gives us an entire picture of a wolf's life in Banff National Park.
That is a very, very cool find, Lori. Thank you for sharing that with us. Discovering predation sites is work that has to be done by getting out in the field and walking in the footsteps of wolves, because even the most sophisticated collars won't show us what is on the menu. Prey animals like deer, elk, bighorn sheep, or moose have to keep on the move and be watchful for wolves sneaking up on them. If we didn't have wolves to thin the herd and make the prey animals nervous, they might stay in one place for too long and graze it right down so that it was hard for other species to live there. For example, elk like to eat young aspen trees. If elk stay in one place and munch down all of the young aspens, then there are no tasty aspens left for the beavers, and the beavers will move somewhere else. If there are no young aspens that are left alone to grow into older aspens, then there are fewer places for songbirds to nest, and they have to move somewhere else as well. You see, the wolves make the elk nervous. So where we have wolves keeping the elk on the move, the aspen can grow, and the beavers and birds both benefit. There's a quote that I love from author Dave Foreman. He says, "What will become of the deer without the wolf to whittle its swift legs?" In other words, if we don't have top predators like wolves, then our ecosystem is neither healthy or complete. We're going to cut to Lori again because I think she's found something else for us now. Lori?
We've stopped in this location because on this tree is one of our most important research tools. This is a motion-activated wildlife camera, and it automatically snaps pictures of animals as they walk by. So it's great for getting to observe reclusive animals like wolves without disturbing their behavior or changing it in any way. Now this camera is here pointed at a rub tree, and that is what I like to call the Facebook of the forest. So it's a tree that somehow the animals have agreed upon, and they all show up, and many different types of species of animals will rub on this tree. They leave their status updates, right? So the bears might scratch on it, the wolves might scratch at the base of it, and instead of writing though, like you would for a status update on Facebook, they leave their messages in pee and poop and hair left behind. And all the other animals come by and sniff that tree and get the messages and see who's in the neighborhood. So it tells us a lot of great information, and we're gonna see a little clip of what this camera has picked up recently.
So here we have the shots from the camera, and the cameras help us to observe the wolf families without disturbing them. We can see if they look well-fed and healthy, or if they look skinny and sick. Now, what do you think about this family that we're seeing now? Do they look pretty well-fed and healthy? I like to think so, yeah. So notice that they chose also to walk along a path. Now, just like us, animals will often use trails to save energy when traveling. And knowing this can help us to place cameras in locations that are likely to catch recordings of wildlife. So how many pups did everyone count? Let's have a look again. So we've got one adult there. And there's our first couple pups. Another one. There's another adult wearing one of our fabulous collars. There's a fourth and a fifth pup there. Interesting coloring differences between the adults and the young pups too. There is our third adult also wearing one of our collars. So I've got five pups and three adults in that sequence. And hopefully you counted the same thing. Now, cameras help us to count how many wolves are in the packs of Banff National Park. wolf populations can go up and down really quickly. They can have a large litter of pups, but then disease or starvation or accidents can quickly reduce the number in the packs. Wolves also have huge home ranges, and they might travel in and out of Banff's boundaries. You see, beyond the park boundary, wolves can be legally hunted or trapped, but that is not allowed inside the national parks. Sometimes we have to go a step further to give the wildlife even more breathing room, and I think Lori can show us one way that we help to protect our wolves in Banff National Park.
All right, friends, we're not going to go any further than this because this red tape actually indicates an area closure here. So this is a seasonal closure for the wolves, because just a little bit further that away, there is a wolf den. So this closure is fairly short, and the wolf babies need about 6 to 8 weeks in their den, uninterrupted, until they're big and strong enough to go ranging with the pack. So we like to give them a little bit of private time away from the paparazzi. So every year, this area gets closed. Now, you know, it's really important to give the wildlife that kind of space away from human activity, because even though we might not intend them any harm, just by being there, sometimes we can make the wolves nervous. They might abandon the den, or we could interrupt their hunting or scare away their prey. So we want to make sure that those wolves have a good sense of home and security in their den area. Now, I have tons of options. There's many places that I can go hike and recreate in the Bow Valley. I don't have to follow this trail today, but the wolves have to have a home that feels secure, right? And when we start interrupting the wild animals' behavior too often, it causes them stress. And when we get stressed, we start to lash out. We might behave badly, right? Well, we want to make sure that our wolves are not feeling that way. So we give them a nice, secure, closed area, free from human activity, where they can raise their babies. So we're going to leave them in peace. We're going to go this way. Okay.
Thank you, Lori, and thank you for giving the animals as much space as you are. So we are always trying to balance protection of the ecosystem with human use of the park. We carefully weigh each case whenever we choose to close an area to human use. See, we have fewer than 50 wolves in the whole park, so each wolf has a potential to see a lot of humans. Banff National Park gets about 4 million visitors every year, and I bet most of them would love to see a wolf. So sometimes we have to insist that the wildlife gets some personal space away from all of us. So I have a sad story to tell you. A couple of years ago, some wolves got into garbage that wasn't properly put away. The wolves started to come back to that same place again and again, looking for more treats from the trash. They started to come close to campgrounds, and usually wolves are wary and shy, but these ones got really bold. The campers couldn't scare them away anymore, and the wolves had become food conditioned and dangerous. In the end, those wolves had to be destroyed because of the thoughtless actions of a few people. Now, we don't have to see sad endings like this if our visitors to Banff follow the wildlife rules, and Lori can tell us what they are.
The wildlife rules. Rule number one. Do not feed any wildlife. All of our wild animals here in Banff National Park have their own natural food sources. And even though you think you might be giving them a little bit of help by offering them a tidbit of your food, you're actually teaching them very bad habits that could ultimately lead to their destruction. So please keep all of your food to yourself. Rule number two, properly store all food and garbage. So if it's garbage, that means you're putting it in one of our bear-proof garbage bins. And believe it or not, they're also wolf-proof. And if you're camping and you have some leftover food that you want to store securely, put it in one of our provided lockers. They're at every campground. Rule number three, give animals lots of space. So I totally get it. It's super exciting to see wild animals out here in Banff National Park. And our first instinct might be to get really close to them, right? But here's the thing. Every time that we go barreling towards an animal, we're stressing it out, we're changing its behavior, and we want to make sure and give our wildlife as much breathing room as possible. So if you see wildlife at the side of the road, go ahead and pull over, and you can use your telephoto lens, you can use your binoculars, you can use the zoom on your phone to get virtually close to those animals. But just make sure that your behavior is not changing their behavior. These are the wildlife rules here in Banff National Park, but I invite you to adopt them wherever you live, because using these wildlife rules can help wildlife to survive and thrive wherever we all are.
Thank you, Lori, for that. I hope that we have provided some inspiration for all of you today. You see, wolves are a fascinating animal. They are an icon of wilderness. They are a keystone species here in Banff National Park. The presence of wolves here in Banff tells us that other parts and processes in our park are working, and that's what we call ecological integrity. The technology that we use to study wolves, like our cameras, our transect studies, and collars, are just as interesting as what we learn from them. That information helps us to make decisions about how to manage use in our national park, balancing values of human use and wildlife conservation. Right, Lori?
And you can help by remembering our wildlife rules and making sure that all of your friends and family know them too.
So now it is your turn to investigate. What questions do you have for us? Let us know in the chat and we will do our best to answer them.
Okay, we have a lot of questions that have come in, and
perfect.
Let's just start at the beginning. I'm just gonna scroll up here. Oops. Right. Oops, just freezing a little bit. I've got a couple of questions that I remember came in before. One of the questions is, why is the wolf scat white, like in that video that Lori was in?
Sounds good.
It's because it's an old scat. So if you've ever had a pet dog before and you maybe missed picking up one of its poops in your yard, after a while that poop will turn white. And it's just something that happens with canine feces.
Okay. Another question that came in from Mr. B, Hub, grade four. If the wolves are eating the mule deer, what does that do to the mule deer population?
Lowers it.
By at least one.
The wolves actually help to keep the mule deer population in check. Like we said in the presentation there, if they didn't have the wolves, then the ungulate populations, which mule deer, white-tailed deer, moose, and elk are all a part of, they would actually eat most of the vegetation in an area before moving on. And without that vegetation, then we don't have proper plant life to help sustain other parts of our ecosystem, like the birds needing places to nest, beavers using the wood for food, animals that need it for shade. There's a very interesting documentary about Yellowstone National Park about when they reintroduced wolves and how by having the wolves there, it actually changed the courses of the rivers. Because the ungulates had been eating the vegetation, the rivers had corroded and changed their direction. They had warmed up because there was no shade, and so there was no fish in the rivers. But when they brought the wolves back, the wolves started to move the elk and the ungulate species around, which caused those trees and vegetation to grow back along the banks of the river, changing it back to its normal course, cooling the waters and allowing fish to go there again. It's a very, very cool documentary. I'm not sure what it's called, but it's Yellowstone National Park and reintroducing wolves. I'm sure if you Googled that, you should be able to find it. But so it is really important that the wolves are there to help keep that white-tailed deer or mule deer population in check. Thank you. I think we're muted or we've lost you there.
Oh, sorry, Phil.
No problem.
So we had a few questions that came in about sort of the relationship between wolves and dogs and what are their similarities and differences. And Candace asked a question, isn't there an animal called a wolf dog?
There is actually, yeah. So wolves and dogs are both part of the canine family, which is the dog family. And a lot of our modern day pet dogs that we have can actually be traced back to historical wolves, and different traits have been bred into them as we have slowly evolved over time. Wolves and dogs can actually mate and create offspring, which is known as the wolf dog. Another member of the canine family that can mate with wolves is also the coyote, and their offspring is called the coy wolf. And I think we might have a slide for that. No, not quite. Sorry. But yeah, so they are related. They are part of the same family species, and they can mate together. There is also usually a size difference between our pet dogs and the wild wolves.
Right. Makes sense. Okay. We've got a question again about how do you collar the wolves? And I know that that was covered in the video, but can you just refresh our memories again on how they're collared?
Absolutely. Yeah. So a team of our conservation officers will go out in a helicopter to find the wolf that we are looking to collar. And they will use a net gun to capture the wolf. They will throw the net over top, which will sort of pin the wolf down. And then they can safely approach the wolf. They use a long sort of stick-like instrument to help pin the wolf down so they can put a muzzle and leg restraints on it. And then while the wolf is being held down by members of the team, they will apply the collar. They will take samples of hair or flesh or blood so that we can use that for DNA testing. And then we let the wolf go and they are very happy to run away from us. And like we said, that whole process is about 10 to 15 minutes. It's a very, wow, very quick, very easy, very non-stressful way of collaring these animals.
Amazing. Okay, I've got a couple of questions came in, honestly, about a different animal, which would be cougars.
Okay.
Like, what is a cougar? And several people mentioned it was basically a puma or a mountain lion. Do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, so those are actually the name for the same animal. Cougars are one of the large cat animals that we have here in North America, and they actually hold the Guinness record for the animal with the most names. So puma, cougar, I believe jaguar is in there as well. Catamount, there's all sorts of names for them. I've never actually been able to find the whole list, but they do hold the record for the animal with the most names. And they are one of the large cat species, like I said. What was the other part of the question there again?
I think you answered the question. Yeah, we're just okay. Wondering essentially, yeah, all the like the different names for them and what they are. So I think you've covered that off.
Okay.
Thank you.
Perfect. No problem.
So we have a question about, do you have any device that sees wolves in their actual dens?
So our motion sensored cameras might be what we use for that. But most of the time, we're actually not going to go and get close to the wolf's den because it is invasive of us to do that. We don't like to bother our animals or cause them stress because, like Lori said, when they get stressed, that's when they're going to start reacting badly towards people. And that could cause some problems for us, especially with how many visitors we have in Banff National Park. So even when we are studying wolves, we try not to get close to their dens. We want them to have that private, safe space where they can raise their pups once they're born. And the pups will actually stay in the den until they're around 6 weeks old, after which they'll be able to start roaming a little bit further with the pack. And then once they're around a year old, they'll be able to start going further and out on their own for hunts.
Great, thank you. I had a similar
question. There's a picture of our cougar there for those of you who are watching the slideshow. So you can see they're really quite large. They're probably on par with the size of wolves. Now, wolves and cougars don't hang out together. They're very wary of each other. If a pack of wolves come by, that cougar would run quickly up a tree or actually jump up a tree because cougars can jump about 18 feet straight up in the air.
Wow, so impressive.
And sorry, what was your question there again?
The question was, what time of year would the wolf pups be born and basically need to stay really close to their den?
So that's happening right now. Yeah, so wolf pups are born in the spring.
Okay, great. How many different types of wolf species live in the Banff area?
So in Banff, we only have one species of wolves, which is the gray wolf or the timber wolf. That is the same species. Laurie's got a slide up for us there. We also know of the red wolf, but that does not live here in Banff, and also the eastern wolf, which does not live here as well. We only have Canis lupus or the gray wolf, which I believe someone mentioned at the very start of this presentation in the chat that they are the largest of the wolf species. And good job, all those facts were all correct.
Somebody was doing their research.
That's right.
I've got a question from Mr. R's class. What is the usual wolf lifespan?
That's a really good question. So wolves usually live anywhere from 9 to 10 years, give or take, but they have been known to live up to 16 years, but that is rare.
Okay, and are the wolves aggressive when we come near their babies? That came from Jenny Elliott, grade 4.
Absolutely. Actually, all animals that are wild animals will be aggressive if you approach their babies or their offspring. One of the animals that causes the most injuries in Banff National Park, believe it or not, is actually the elk. And that is because during their calving season, they will drop their calves off on maybe the side of a trail where they are off eating, maybe, you know, 20 feet or so away. The calves don't have any scent, so the mothers don't want to be near them while they're eating. So they'll leave them at the side of a trail, go off and eat. And then unknowingly to us, we will walk by that calf that's hiding nicely and the elk will come and charge us. And if anyone has visited the Parks Canada YouTube channel, there's a great video where our conservation officers had to grab one of the calves from the Banff Center and run it away from the mother to have it leave one of our campuses, one of the schools here, to help protect the people. So it's not just our predator animals like wolves and bears that will be aggressive if you approach their young, but even our prey animals such as deer, elk, and moose can be very, very aggressive when it comes to protecting their young. You don't want to mess with mamas. Make sure you give the animals lots of space. As a matter of fact, when it comes to our predator animals, we recommend 100 meters of distance between them, especially if they have their young. So if you need a visualization for that, it is 10 school bus lengths. And for our prey animals like the elk and deer, then you're looking at 30 meters, which is 3 school bus lengths.
Wow, that's quite a distance. It's really good to know that.
That's why you need your telephoto lens when you're out in town.
Or binoculars.
Yeah.
Question from Mr. B's Hub, grade 4 again. How often do wolves howl?
That's a really good question. I don't think we have a number of how often they howl, but I can tell you some of the reasons that they might howl. Wolves will howl to gather their pack together and to communicate over long distances. If you come to Banff and you go out to Lake Minnewanka late at night, if you're lucky, you can often hear wolves howling in the distance. Wolves will also howl to mourn. If a member of their pack is killed, if an alpha dies, if they've lost someone, then they will howl to mourn that wolf. It is a really, really fascinating way of communication. And an interesting fact, wolves don't bark. That was bred into dogs as we started to domesticate them and make them our pets. And most of our pets don't howl because that was bred out of them.
Wow, so does that mean if my dog howls, they might be a wolf?
They might be closer to a wolf than a dog, than a pet dog. That's right, yeah. same with their ears, the pointy ears of wolves. The reason a lot of our dog's ears kind of droop like this is because that was bred into them as we domesticated them.
Wow, fascinating. Okay, we've got a question here from Anonymous. Have you guys captured video footage of wolves actually eating their prey?
I'm sure that we could find some. I don't think we have any accessible at the moment that we could show you. But I there's some great, if you ever watch the Yellowstone documentary, there's a pack of wolves that take down a bison, and that is really cool. Actually, I think we have video footage somewhere in our files of that. I would not be able to find it right now, unfortunately. But there's some cool footage out there of wolves taking down bison or deer. And it is cool to watch because they do work as a team. And, you know, they will surround the one animal and they will nip it and sort of chase it in the direction that they want it to go. It's really, really a cool thing to see, although it can be quite gruesome.
Yes, I can imagine that. Jenny Elliott's grade four class wanted to know, do we know how many wolves live in Canada? Bit of a trivia question.
Sure, absolutely. So we have about 7,000 wolves in Alberta. These are estimates, of course, because it is very hard to keep track of definite numbers. And then we have about 200,000 to 250,000 wolves in the world. So I don't have the number for Canada, but worldwide is around 200,000 to 250,000. And in Alberta, it's around 7,000 wolves.
Wow, that's a lot. I've got a question from Mr. R's class. Are the wolves being kept in that area, or do they just happen to roam there? So I'm not sure if that means, are they enclosed in Banff National Park or?
No, so our wolves are free to roam and travel wherever they want. We don't have any fences around their denning sites. We don't have any fences around the entire national park that keep animals in. Like we said in the presentation, that wolves are able to leave the boundaries of Banff National Park. When they are outside of the boundaries, they are legally able to be hunted and trapped. But within the park, they are safe by protections and watched over by our researchers and conservation officers to make sure that they are safe. Again, with GPS collars and radio collars is sort of how we do that. But with their denning sites, they are not contained. We also do have fences along the highway, and some of our overpasses and underpasses are ways that we allow the wolves to travel around Banff National Park. And this is a really, really good thing for all of our animals. By fencing the highway, we manage to stop the wolves from being hit by cars and trucks, because this is a very, very, very busy highway. Like I said, we get about 4 million visitors every year, and which means that there is a car that goes down that highway about every 2.5 seconds. So not much chances for animals to get across. So by fencing it and building those overpasses, we keep their habitat connected, and we actually use our DNA studies to find out if our wolves are able to travel around the valley freely and safely. And we can show through these studies that wolves do in fact get around the valley safely. They are using these underpasses and overpasses to travel around. But that's the only fencing we have, is to keep the animals safe, not to contain them.
Right, and that was one of my follow-up questions, is with those tunnels and those overpasses, I was wondering, did it take the wolves some time to learn to use those? Did you see any changes in their tracks once those overpasses were put in?
Absolutely, yeah. So wolves were one of the last of our large species to sort of get used to and use the overpasses. Of course, the elk and the deer, our ungulate species, were some of the first, and they are the most numerous species to use the overpasses. Of course, that is because they do have larger population numbers than most of our other animals. But the wolves do use it, our bears use it, and we have video and pictures of these animals actually teaching their young how to use these crossing structures. I'll bring up one here on my slideshow. This is one of my favorite slides. No, it's not working. Hold on. Why isn't that working? Oh, because I hit from beginning. There we go. So we'll throw this up there. So this overpass was actually still under construction when this mama grizzly bear with her cubs decided that she would show them where to cross. So these animals are teaching their young where they are so that they can use them in the future. And wolves are no different. They will use it as well and teach their young where they are.
Wow, that's so fascinating. And I'm so grateful that the animals have learned to use those.
It's actually lowered the amount of animals killed on the highways by over 90%.
Wow, that's great. I've got a question from Joshua. Have there ever been any wolf attacks in Banff National Park?
Unfortunately, there has been wolf attacks on people in Banff National Park. It is extremely, extremely rare. We have one case that happened a couple of years ago where we had a very sick wolf that attacked someone in their tent. And unfortunately, that wolf could not be saved and relocated and had to be destroyed.
That's sad, for sure. Jenny Elliott, grade four, they are asking, how many wolf pups are in a pack and how many wolf pups are in a litter?
That is a really, really good question. We don't really have definite numbers. When they're born, it can be anywhere from like 2 to 4, sometimes 6, and it sort of depends on how well they're eating that year. So if the food is really well and they're eating really well, then they might have more pups. If there's less food, then they will have fewer pups. Okay. And within the pack, again, that number can change drastically. We had pretty much an entire pack that was wiped out because they were hit by a train. The wolf pups were hanging around the train tracks and they ended up getting run over. But we can have up to 11 pups in a pack.
Wow, that's a lot. Okay. Do the wolves swim in the water? We have a question on that.
Yeah, wolves can swim, absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you can actually sometimes catch some wolves fishing. A lot of times our water levels will change drastically and we'll have little ponds where some sucker fish or bottom feeder fish will get stuck in these ponds before they dry up, and bears and wolves will just have a field day just eating as much of them as they possibly can.
Yeah, take advantage of the opportunity, I guess.
Exactly, yeah, especially the bears.
Yes. A question from Anonymous here. What will you do if a disease gets into the wolves and the population declines?
So unfortunately, we have a policy of not interrupting natural processes. So if a wolf pack were to get a disease that would decimate the pack, we wouldn't really do anything to stop that from happening because it is a natural cause of death. However, if the wolves were for some reason to be absolutely 100% wiped out, then we might start looking into reintroduction programs, kind of like what we've done recently with our bison.
Right. Thank you for that. We have a question about, so why can't we feed our leftover food to the wolves?
That's a really good question. So I talked a little bit briefly earlier about the domestication of wolves and how we turn them into pets. And that's kind of what happens. When you start giving wildlife food from people, then they start to expect food from people and they start to lose their fear of us. And this isn't good because it means that they're more willing to come closer to us. They're going to possibly become aggressive if they don't get food from us. Or say you fed a wolf and he's become your friend, but then the next people to show up at that campsite come and they don't want to give the wolf food, then the wolf would become aggressive towards those people. So it can be extremely, extremely dangerous to feed any wildlife. Not only that, but our food isn't exactly the healthiest of foods, right? So these wolves are used to eating really natural foods that don't have a lot of chemicals and byproducts in them. And, you know, if they get a hold of a Snickers bar or start eating too many, you know, packages of bread, it can make them really, really sick. And some of our animals can end up being obese, unhealthy. They can get diabetes just like us. And it can be really, really bad and unhealthy for these animals, including unsafe for the animals and the people. Animals that usually end up getting fed human food on most occasions end up having to be destroyed.
And I think someone asked before, when you say destroyed, do you mean they're killed, right?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. It's very sad. We don't like to do it. But unfortunately, when people make a mistake, the animals are the ones who end up suffering.
Yeah, thank you for that. I guess I've got a question here also on the theme of what wolves are eating. Mm-hmm. How big are the animals that wolves eat? Like, can they eat bison or bears? Like, say, a large moose?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. We're talking about pack animals, so it's not just one animal that's going to be eating these large, large animals. Wolves will take down bison. They will eat bison. They will take down moose and deer and elk and all those animals that we talked about. And with a kill, they'll often eat up to about 9 kilograms of food at a time. and then they'll leave the rest, which will be eaten by scavengers such as ravens or other corvid species, and then bugs, wolverines, etc. There we go. We've got a picture of a wolf at a kill. Looks like a deer, possibly. And then if you look, you can actually see that wolf is really close to a couple of ravens who are there just enjoying the kill. And there's actually been studies done that show that ravens can lead wolves to prey, so that they will hunt the prey and then the ravens will be able to eat the scraps that are left over.
So a case of interspecies teamwork.
Absolutely. Yeah, symbiosis.
Great. So there's a question about the collars. People are just wondering, do the collars stress the wolves, do you think? Or do you find that that changes their behaviors at all?
It won't change their behaviors. It might stress them out briefly at first. Again, we're very careful not to make it an extremely stressful situation when we are collaring them. It's done very quickly and they are released very quickly. And then, you know, they might sort of notice the collar for a couple days and then eventually they'll get used to it. The collars are not put on the wolves tightly. We make sure that there is enough room that it can move around freely, but it won't fall off of the wolves. You can see there, it's not choking the wolves. It's not causing them to discomfort. They do get used to it. Actually, I really like this picture because the wolf in front has got a collar, and then it kind of looks like the wolves in the background are laughing at him for his jewels.
I hope not.
But they do get used to it, absolutely. And the collars are made to fall off. So if the wolf were to get stuck or in a situation where the collar needed to break apart, that little piece of fabric that we saw Lori showing us, it's a very old piece of fabric that will tear easily and eventually it will fall off the wolves.
Almost like Velcro, I guess.
A little bit stronger than Velcro.
Yeah. Okay. Good question here. How do you tell a male wolf from a female wolf?
That would be done with our researchers. When they are collaring the animals, they would have to check. Like most canines, you can kind of see if you're close enough whether it is a male or female by looking underneath the animal. Also, the size can be a giveaway of the sex of the animal, although that would also depend on the animal's age and how well it's been eating.
Okay, so it wouldn't just be an automatic that if a wolf is larger, that it's not necessarily the male?
Not necessarily. It's a good guess because we could see the size of the wolf and be like, oh, that might be a male. And then we can maybe use our telescopes or binoculars to get a closer look at the undercarriage of the animal and see which gender it might actually be.
Right, exactly. Okay, we have a question about, you know, you mentioned before that when you put the collars on the wolves that you might take some samples, like mm-hmm. blood or tissue samples. So someone's wondering, wouldn't that hurt the wolf?
No, it's just like when you go to the doctor, you know, we take a needle with a little bit of a blood sample. Sometimes we don't even have to approach the animal. We can actually use what's called a barbed wire hair snare. And what this does is it doesn't hurt the animal. They basically brush against it and they leave some of their fur behind. And then we can gather that and collect it for DNA studies. Sometimes we'll put these on rub trees. Like what Lori was talking about, where we will bait the trees using fish oils or dead beaver carcasses to attract animals to it. And then we can collect the hair from that barbed wire and use that for our studies.
Okay, great. I got a question here about how fast can a wolf run? I mean, I would imagine it's similar to a dog, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think it's somewhere around 60 kilometers an hour is the average max speed of a wolf, something along those lines. I might have it here. Let me just take a quick peek. Yes, around 60 kilometers an hour.
Okay, that's pretty fast.
Yes. You cannot outrun our wild animals. As a matter of fact, we don't recommend running from any predator animals because then you automatically become the prey in their mind. If you are running from them, you are food. So never run from a wolf or a bear or a cougar or a wolverine. Stand your ground, make some noise, let them know you're coming, and hopefully everyone can leave safe.
Absolutely. Someone was asking about temperature cameras.
Oh, and also if you are hiking, bear spray. I should mention bear spray. It is a must-have when you are hiking in Banff National Park.
So that would work just as well with wolves?
Absolutely. It works on wolves. It works on elk and deer if they are aggressive. It'll work on humans too, but don't do that.
Good point. Someone was asking, can wolves climb a tree just like bears?
No, wolves are not known for their climbing capabilities. They might sort of walk somewhat up a tree if it's kind of fallen at a slant to get something that might be in the tree, but they do not climb trees, no.
Okay. So we're actually out of time. So I just let you run your last slide. And thanks everybody for your questions. And I think you guys will be able to stay online for a bit longer to answer some of those questions in Q&A.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. So before we go, I want to let everyone know about our Wildlife Rules Poster Challenge. So we invite all of you to take one thing that you learned about wildlife rules today and turn it into a drawing that will help everybody else understand that rule. Once you've completed your poster, you can share it with us using the hashtag Wildlife Rules and tag us at BanffNP so that we can see your wonderful ideas. There's also one more thing to remember, and that is admission to the national parks and historic sites is free for kids under 17. So I look forward to seeing all of you in Banff National Park one of these days. Thank you very much for joining us. Have a great afternoon.